importers, particularly importers, are concerned about the time and transaction costs of clearance of goods and services. In the last 2-3 years, have you seen any intervention by Gapuha under his previous leadership to reform the ports to respond to contemporary trade needs?
And I think that dealing with this question, there's a need to go a little back to look at what has been done by previous administrations to really buttress the point, the fact that indeed there has been improvements in the clearance of cargo at the port. I recall in the Economic Recovery Program 1 and 2, when the former president was in office, the ports, both Tema and Takoradi, went through a lot of transformation. I recall when ships were very difficult to berth, sometimes because of the enormity of ships that have wrecked within the ports. I recall about a total of 139 ships were removed from the ports. And Chairman Rawlings did his bit. Then when the MPP came under President Kufuor, when Mr. Benno Usumeza was also there, some infrastructure was also carried. When you look at the Shed 1 and 2, they have to extend the port to about 200 meters into the sea. Then with the grafts of about between 12 and 13, so that they can be able to take in more ships that have come to discharge their cargo at the port. Then also when you go to the Golden Jubilee Terminal, a lot of infrastructure was done there because the old transit sheds for cocoa were all demolished, you know, and to give way for containerization at the port and all that. So something was done. So they have to relocate the cocoa shed at Jatabu, close to the western end of the port. Then it opened up. Then came to the current administration. Something good has been done. And I can say that the immediate past director general, Mr. Richard Anamu, and his team have done so well. Why do I say this? Because when you look at currently the ports, there's a need for us to have a lot of things to be done. And I'm looking in terms of currently where you have a reefer yard. The reefer yard basically is about poultry products that have been imported in containers that are brought hitherto. They were kept in certain areas within the port. That really causes a lot of congestion. So now they've created a separate reefer yard within the port area, which is enhancing the clearance at the port. Now you have a revenue office. Hitherto it was within the port where the fire service is. It has been taken out of the port because of the traffic flow of users of the port in paying revenue to GPH or that. They have to relocate the revenue department outside the port, close to where the Tema head office is. It's also there. There is something that they also did, which I think that is very important and significant.
Lee, it's okay. You just wanted to acknowledgement that something has been done.
Yeah, something has been good, has been done.
That's okay. Please.
Chairman, having served on the Trade and Industry Committee of Parliament, I can refer you to many parliamentary records that you are emphatic on the establishment of the International Trade Commission. And having worked with GASM and Cement, you are particular about fighting dumping and the use of those instruments to fight dumping. Having been named now as Deputy Minister Designate for Transport, you certainly will have a natural working relationship with the Ministry of Trade. What will you do so that our port does not become dumping grounds?
Are protected so that we can create jobs for our people. Thank you.
I have a background in labor relations management. And he recalls that I went somewhere with him to dance jama with the labor union. So when he was telling the Honorable Ablakwa about identifiable groups, Chairman, he used to be a strong advocate of a strong partner of the Tema Workers Union, and shared a view about contract employment, particularly within Tema and its environs, of every worker relationship being defined at the level of contract. Now that you'll be strengthened with a political hand, will you do justice to the problem of the casual worker, particularly at the port with your minister?
Mr. Chairman, indeed it is so. I can't do this on my own. I need to support my minister. They will look at the terms within which this contracts of workers within the port area, even beyond the port area, how it is done. So long as I have the support of my minister, I'm going to aid him to make sure the right things are done within the work environment. Thank you.
I have a question on the future of public transportation in Ghana. When you look around the cities and also look at the state of our metro mass buses, you will see a very sorry situation. And in several countries, especially in the developed world, people rely so much on public transportation. Do you have any future? Do you have any hope for our public transportation in Ghana?
What I can say briefly is about leadership of some of these men and women who are handling our national transportation system. And I think that so long as I have a very strong and humble minister for transport, I will consult him. I will knock on his door so that together all of us will find out how best we can do to deal with the problems of our national transportation system, i.e. the state transport and the metro mass transport. You know, sometimes you look at the way they handle some of these national assets, it is a worry. And you need a disciplined, you know, leadership within these organizations with the right policy, superintended by the minister, and myself aiding him to make sure the right things are done. So I think that, yes, we have a future in these state transports that we have in our country.
That is people from my constituency, the drivers of smaller buses, the private owners of buses, complain that the places where they park their vehicles have been overtaken by the metro mass buses. And I would like to appeal to you and your minister to do something about it. It is a major concern. They come to Accra and they don't have any place to park. So I hope that you do something about this.
Yes, yes, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much. It's a good advice.
Yes, no, you have had your chance. Anybody else? Yes, that's right.
We see a lot of these motorcycle riders riding with impunity on our roads as if they are not subject to any of the road traffic regulations. They jump through red lights with impunity, cross vehicles with abandon. What are you going to do to ensure that so long as we have these motorcycle riders on our roads?
That is our duty, to deal with any motor rider who fall foul of the law. My ministry and that of my minister, our only role is to make sure we give the necessary policy direction and how it should be enforced and all that. So I think that it is the work of the police to deal with the enforcement of the law. Thank you.
Okay. there is a law, legislation in place banning the commercial use of motorcycles for carrying passengers. And yet, well, in common parlance, Okada. And yet, you, as if you are confirmed, you'll be in the Ministry of Transport as a deputy minister there. And I believe, even though it may be a law enforcement issue, it is also your within your remit to ensure that the policies that you implement, you propose and you put forth, are giving effect to. So what would you do? One, do you think we should use motorcycles to carry passengers? Two, if depending on the answer you give to that question, should we enforce the law or should we repeal the law?
Mr. Chairman, this is a very difficult issue to deal with. The application of the law is the work of the police. On another hand, it is one of the major means of transport into areas where that are not accessible, where vehicles cannot go. So in a way, they are playing a very crucial role in the general transportation of our people. As to whether we should ban it or not, what I would say is that, respectfully, that is a position of the law. I agree with you. But what I'm saying is that I don't have the power. It is the work of the police. And I'll have to support my minister and see what we could all do to deal with the problem of enforcement.
Titus Glover, if you see a motorcycle on the street, can you tell whether it's for commercial purpose or for private use?
Mr. Chairman, it's very difficult to distinguish between normal commercial motorcycle and a private motorcycle. What is important is to make sure that those two riders have their helmet on or they are being stopped by the police and checked. Then we can distinguish between who is a private or a commercial motor rider.
So, as far as I'm concerned, no motorcycle has ever been licensed to do commercial work. If you agree to pay somebody and sit right behind him, it's your choice. If you don't take a helmet and you crack your skull, it's your choice. If a motorcycle rider is misconducting himself on the road, driving against traffic roads, and you get crashed, it's your choice. People should just be made to know the risk. And then our own safety. Yeah. Anymore.
Ni kwate Titus Glover.
You honorable Suhini.
Let me start on this note. If for whatever disagreement with you, I refer to you as an educated illiterate, will you find that complimentary or insulting?
Mr. Chairman, sorry. It depends. It reminds me of my big brother, Nia Lute Jacobs, the chairman for the NDC in the Central Region. That's how he describes himself. So it depends on how you use it. You understand? It depends on the way you use it and the relationship with the person. So I don't think anything wrong about it, depending on the thoughts you have about the context at which you want to address the person. If you call me, I'm a grandson of a fisherman, so if you call me educated fisherman, I don't have a problem.
Well, that was not what I proposed. I proposed educated illiterate. I hope our General Secretary, Asiedu Nketiah, is listening, and I'm sure he will be satisfied with your answer. You once referred to him as an educated literate. Illiterate. I didn't find that complimentary. So if we are all preaching reconciliatory language, it's important that we are fair to each other. But my next question has to do with the expansion at our ports, especially as championed by the previous government, the previous NDC government. And one of the ports happens to be in your constituency. So my question to you is, how has this expansion led to, for example, job creation in the Tema enclave? And as it was championed by the previous CEO, Mr. Anamu, what has been your working relationship with them as they did these expansions?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The immediate past Director General is a very good friend and a big brother. I've known him for about 30, 33 years in Tema. Whilst he was a civil engineer in the port, my father was a terminal manager at cargo handling. So our relationship dates back those years. In my previous answer to the same question by the Honorable Minority Leader as to the improvement of infrastructure in the port to enhance easy clearance of goods in the port, I alluded to the fact that, yes, previous government have done their bit. President Rawlings did his best. President Kufuor under Mr. Usumensa did his best. And let me also say that President Mama under Mr. Richard Anamu has also done his best at his time. When I was enumerating some of the things that he has done, I forgot to say that there is one infrastructure IT project that he initiated called the JADE project, the Terminal Operating System. This is where ships that call it into the port, because of the involvement in human discretion, the IT infrastructure has positioned itself in such a way that when the ship call into the port and stevedoring operations start immediately, it triggers the generation of the invoice without the inclusion of any human involvement and all that. So I think that he has done his best under the circumstance, and I must say that he needs to be commended like other predecessors that work in the port, like Ben Usumensa and others.
Now, to my last question, maybe before that, there are some things I have noticed on the CV, and I will just maybe seek your clarification on it and wrap up with my last question. It has to do with how you transition from a certificate in employment relations to MA, comparative labor relations. I don't know the requirements that the university has for MA, but I know the normal standard is that you would have been expected to have at least a bachelor's, a good degree, first degree. But I see certificate in employment relations and then MA comparative relations. And when you were speaking earlier about your early life, you spoke of being one of the pioneers for DEX preparatory. I don't see that indicated here, and I'm wondering why. And maybe to the final question, what will you say has been your best work experience beyond being a member of parliament?
First of all, in Warwick, I was first engaged, enrolled as a postgraduate diploma. In my coursework, if I proceed well, then I was given the opportunity to do a dissertation, and that led to the award of the MA certificate for me. The DEX school, like I said, it was started in the veranda opposite Lagoon Clinic in Site 13 in Tema. Who were the first pioneers that started the school? So whilst that was at age four, then when I was 6 years, I was born in August. So in September, I left and I went to class one in Chidasi Primary School. Then they relocated from the veranda in the house in Site 13 to its present place in Committee 8. So that is what I can share with you. Then your last, can I have what you said, what I've done?
Yes, work experience.
Oh, not necessarily in politics. I think that's way back when I was working in Alouettes, I represented the workers as once their secretary and as their chairman. I have done a lot of negotiations, understanding joint negotiations on behalf of the workers. And I can say that I will not sit here to pride myself. When you go to Aluworks today, and the working community in Tema, they can attest to the fact that whilst I was leading workers, I was that honest, very humble, hardworking, to make sure that the right things are done for both managers, management, and workers, and all that.
You noticed that you generated some response when you were describing your qualities. How will you define your temperament? How do you consider your temperament? You are going to work with a very calm minister, and we know the transport ministry is also a very, very technical area. You have very celebrated technocrats in that sector. The perception of you is that you are more of the radical type. Every now and then we hear news from your constituency, some agitation and, you know, some aggression and all of that. Will you say that you are well suited for this role? And what assurance can you give this committee and your minister that you will go and assist and steady very calmly, and you are not going to stir any waters and rock the boat at the transport ministry?
Mr. Chairman, I want to assure this committee and the people of this country that before the president invited me, he shared some of these things with me. And I can assure you, I have a very wonderful working relationship with my minister way, 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 way back. And our partner, you see a lot of success and growth in the Ministry of Transport. I'm going to respect him, giving all the support. If he wants, I'll even lie down for him to work on it.
Lying down is not part of your responsibility.
Pronouncements of the honorable nominee, having gone through his record in parliament, I hold in my hands the Hansard for 27 November 2013. Wednesday, 27 November 2013, column 1513. You made a passionate call on the then Minister of Transport to address a particular issue. You said, I quote, Mr. Speaker, I'm saying this because it is so sad that the big maritime players are taking the businesses that are meant for our people. Mr. Speaker, I hold in my hands the Ghana Shipping Act 2003, and with your permission, I beg to quote. I don't want to proceed, but just to say that you complained about how in the maritime industry you described foreign big players of taking over the space, and that your work as MP for the area, Tema East, which has our ports, which hosts our ports, you were concerned about what was happening to Ghanaian maritime players. What will be your proposals now, as fate will have it, some 4 years after you have the opportunity to assist your minister to address this concern that you spoke about in Parliament 4 years ago?
This very statement, that was when we were passing the Ghana GIPC bill. And what I can say is that I have a minister in charge of the ministry, and I'm sure he's going through a lot of some of these things. I will consult my minister and see how best some of these things can be addressed. Indeed, the people of this country, there are certain jobs, when you go to the GIPC Act, the Article 26, there are certain jobs that are reserved for Ghanaians to do. So it will be very difficult and painful that jobs that will be meant for our people have been taken away from other people. So I think that all I need to do, patiently, that when this committee recommends my approval at the plenary, I go back to the ministry. I will have a discussion with my minister. Then going forward, we'll see what we do to deal with the problem.
My last question has to do with the reforms that the previous government started with the Tema shipyard and the movements, how we secured it back from the Malaysians. We now have total control. Are you conversant? Have you been briefed on those reforms? And what kind of support do you intend to give your minister to make sure that this very, very important national asset gets back to its glorious days? We had to manufacture the two FPSOs in Jurong, Singapore, whilst we could have done that here. We have done that before as a country. How do you intend to support the minister to achieve this?
Mr. Chairman, I thank my colleague for this concern. And the history of the dry docks and shipyard dates way back. And it's painful when you see national asset like this going down the drain. I can assure this committee that when I go, when you have the opportunity to recommend my approval to the plenary, I will consult my minister. That is my constituency. It's a national asset, and it's my work. Therefore, whatever good thing that will make shipyard and dry docks operational, I will support my minister to let it work. Thank you.
Giving him just one friendly, harmless question. Honorable nominee, passengers queue and in most cases struggle at the various bus, terminals in search of vehicles to be able to get to their destinations. It is the aspiration of every Ghanaian, especially the ordinary Ghanaian, that government and all other stakeholders in the transport industry will be able to provide very consistent and efficient transport system in our country. How do you propose to address this challenge?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that is more or less improvement of our infrastructure in our bus terminals. Unfortunately, we don't seem to be using our public transport system depending on where you find yourself. Because when you go to other advanced countries, by a phone call, you can have a taxi at your doorstep to take you to where you want to go. But where you want to use the normal public means of transport and the people that call into that particular terminal to board buses to our destination sometimes are more than the liability of those buses that are there. So first of all, how to address this thing is to support my minister to ensure that these transport terminals that we have, if one, we have a land space that can accommodate, more of these our passengers, so that when they come, they have a good, comfortable place to sit whilst they wait for these buses to call in, that is fine. But that could be done in support or in connection with the metropolitan assemblies, because it is the assemblies that need to provide these terminals, because they're taking all the parking tolls from these transporters and all that. So I think that the Ministry of Transport, I will support my minister, to liaise with these assemblies to make sure that enough parking spaces are provided so that our passengers can have a very comfortable place to sit while they await for buses to call in and then continue their journeys to their various destinations.
You have been called Etama boy. Are you aware of the relationship, sometimes not good relationship, between Gapuha, the Navy, and the TDC? You know them very well. TMA also. What is the relationship? And how will you assist your minister to resolve any issues if they are?
Honorable Chairman, what my senior yellow-chair is telling me is news to me, because I have no clue. And I'm sure if indeed there is a problem and they cannot resolve among themselves, my boss will be informed and I'll have the opportunity to know what these problems are, and then all of us together, we can have a resolution to the problem.
It is, you know, the perennial problem as who owns what, who should collect revenue for what. You know, TMA, TDC, and then in the fishing rights and all that, Navy says we are in charge. Gapoa says we are in charge. So that is what I'm talking about. So are you not aware?
Mr. Chairman, these are purely administrative matters. And sitting here, I don't have the capacity. God willing, when I'm cleared and the plenary approves my nomination, I will consult my minister. Should any of these problems come to attention, all of us together, we can deal with the problem. Thank you.
Admittedly, you are aware. Are you aware or you are not aware?
Mr. Chairman, when it comes to my attention, I will consult my minister.
Honorable Eric Opoku raised the issue of the terminals, and you attempted to give some explanation. But you also know that under the World Bank arrangements, the various metropolitan, municipal and district assemblies within the Greater Accra region were put on the Ayalolo BRT. No, under my leadership as Minister for Local Government, I passed the law for the ministry. How are you going to make sure that you support your minister to reduce the waiting time for people who want to get to Accra and also avoid heavy traffic by making use of the buses for the BRT?
Mr. Chairman, I didn't get his question. You only give some background, but you didn't ask exactly what the question is, so I can deal with it.
You partly answered the question by saying that you liaise with the metropolitan and MDAs and to resolve the problems of the confusion at the terminals. Now, I'm saying that there is even the bus rapid transit system. And I'm saying, how will you and your minister, how will you manage this to reduce the traffic, heavy traffic? Because if people know, they can come in and get back without bringing their personal cars, all will help. What are you going to do to support your minister to do this?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know there is a dedicated route for these transports called the Ayalolo. And I'm aware that my ministry very soon will be doing something similar in Adentang and few other places. So that the concept of this idea is to make sure that we avoid this congestion on our road, to make sure that these buses can have a smooth drive on our roads. So education is also important. Sometimes our drivers must also help. The unnecessary congestion on the road, they park anywhere, they pick passengers. So they should cooperate with the police to make sure that the road are cleared for easy access and all that.
Thank you very much. As you know, in the transport sector, in many cities all over the world, you have trams introduced to take care of them. I know the railways ministry may be responsible. Will it be something that you can collaborate with them to also introduce Ghana to reduce travel time?
Mr. Chairman, this is a very laudable advice by my senior, and I think that I'm a deputy, and I'll consult my minister, God willing, when it becomes feasible, that we should have a tram system within our cities and all that. It's a means of transport for our people. So it's a laudable idea. My minister is in charge. We'll look at it if it becomes possible, why not?